How's it going? This video is going to be a practical overview of the SSRI side effects. And I'm going to be going one by one into each symptom just to give it more context. And I'll also be going over what some of the options are if you have a patient that experiences the side effects. And in the last video, I discussed how I like to split up the different side effects into four different categories. So let's get started on the symptoms that are early and self-limiting. So to quickly review, these are symptoms that typically start as soon as the patient starts the medications. And self-limiting means that they typically get better over time as the person adjusts to the medication. But I think it's important to give realistic expectations with patients. So I would make sure to let the patient know that typically these symptoms do get better, but that's not an absolute guarantee. So the first side effect I want to go over are GI side effects. And if you're not in the medical biz, GI side effects just mean gastrointestinal side effects. So it's like nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, stuff like that. So the fact that serotonin is considered the happy molecule or the happy neurotransmitter is really more the result of really good marketing than it is a physiological fact. More than 90% of serotonin is located in the gut, so it's probably more accurate to call it the puking shit neurotransmitter. So basically every antidepressant can cause nausea as a side effect, and for SSRIs, SNRIs, really anything that is involved in serotonin, it's typically around like 20 to 25%. So the increase in nausea and vomiting is as a result of the increased amount of serotonin available to the gut, which then acts on 5-HT3 receptors. So in animal studies, activation of the 5-HT3 receptors causes emesis or vomiting. So the tendency for nausea to wear off with time is probably due to the fact that there's downregulation of these receptors. Diarrhea is also a known side effect of the medication and occurs probably around 10% of the time. For whatever reason, sertraline anecdotally seems to be worse, occurring probably like 20% of the time, giving it the appropriate nickname squirtraline. You can pretty much predict the effect of a medication on your bowels just by its mechanism. So we know that serotonin increases gut motility, so that increases the diarrhea and whatnot. Acetylcholine and norepinephrine decrease gut motility, so we know that probably constipation is the more likely side effect. So what should you do if you have a patient who complains of these side effects? In most cases, the nausea wanes after about 2 or 3 weeks, but it does persist in probably a third of the patients. So first off, we know that food slows the absorption process while leaving the extent of the absorption unchanged. So taking SSRIs with meals can help minimize some of the GI effects. We also know the nausea tends to be dose related, so some patients might find relief if you make the doses twice a day. And since it's dose related, lowering the medication might decrease the side effects. If you had a patient who struggled to tolerate the GI side effects, it's helpful to keep in mind that mirtazapine stands alone as the only antidepressant that basically never causes nausea. And actually it can be helpful for nausea because it's a 5-HT3 antagonist. So it's basically just a poor man's version of Zofran. All right, so the next side effect is anxiety. The early anxiety tends to be a result of the fact that the medication can make people feel jittery or a little agitated or a little irritable at first. And psychiatrists tend to use code words to make themselves feel like they're smarter. So for some reason, we call the early anxiety activation. Some other words that make you sound smarter. Don't say add a medication, you say augment. And you don't increase the dose, you titrate it. But I get off track. So this general jittery, uncomfortable, anxious, activating quality seems to be worse with Prozac. So with Prozac, the treatment emergent anxiety / nervousness occurs about 14% of the time. And it also seems to be a little bit higher with Effexor. It seems to happen to occur like 10 to 12% of the time. And on the flip side, some people use the Prozac intentionally for patients who could use a little bit of the activation. So these stimulation-like side effects typically develop within the first few weeks of treatments. They tend to be dose-related, time-limited, and they occur more frequently after a rapid increase in the dose. And just a heads up, contrary to popular belief, bupropion is no more likely to worsen anxiety than an SSRI. The data kind of shows it's probably less likely than Prozac or Effexor. So what can you do about it? The strategies to treat or prevent SSRI-induced stimulation is to begin the treatment with a low dose, especially with anxious patients. That should be the first consideration. And when it does occur, you should consider a slower titration. The jitteriness tends to be time-limited, so waiting for tolerance to develop is a good strategy. Some people actually use an anxiolytic at the beginning of treatment, so they also prescribe like a benzo or propranolol in the first few weeks. The logic here is it can enhance compliance, and then you kind of just plan to take the anxiolytic off after a few weeks. But I would really only consider this in special circumstances. I don't think it's standard of care. There aren't just the biological risks of the benzos, but the psychological risks of the benzos. Benzos are addicting, and once you know there's a medication that you can take and instantly feel better, it can be psychologically difficult to accept that your SSRIs don't make you instantly feel better, and the effects aren't really as perceptible. So let's move on. The next set of side effects we're gonna go over are sedation and insomnia. And I know you're thinking, wait, what? Those are like opposites. So I think it's a good time to mention that the side effects of the SSRIs are really like infinite and opposite and contradictory to each other. One dude gets constipated, one dude gets diarrhea, you know, you can't predict it. We can really only say that some occur at a higher probability, and it's impossible to say which particular side effect a patient will get. So with the SSRIs, most people don't really report a ton of sedation or sleepiness. It's really only like a minority of patients, like 10-ish percent. Paxil tends to be the worst, like 20-ish percent, and that's easy to remember because of the anti-muscarinic effects. I also found it interesting that Effexor or venlafaxine can be sedating, which is kind of the opposite of what you expect from its mechanism of action. So all I can say there is not everything in the world makes sense. The one thing that's good to know is that tolerance is more commonly seen with the activating side effects as opposed to the sedating side effects. One thing that's helpful to remember is that if a medication is dosed once a day, you can really take it any time of the day you want. So if it's taken Q-day, if it makes them sleepy, just tell the patient to take it at night. If it makes them wake up, don't take it at night. The only thing that really matters is you try to take the medication at roughly the same time each day. So if a patient tells you it works best when they take it at 3:54 p.m., have them take it at 3:54 p.m. So if a patient has sedation, try to switch to nighttime dosing. If it's intolerable, you can try switching to another SSRI or SNRI, or maybe a less sedating medication like bupropion. If you feel like being a wild man, you can add a low dose of stimulant with caution. But that brings us to insomnia. So basically all the SSRIs and SNRIs can cause insomnia, typically like 15-ish percent of the time. Lexapro might be a little less likely to cause it. Like I said earlier, people like to say that Prozac is the most activating and the more likely to cause insomnia, but it wasn't really reflected in the product monograph numbers. So initial management strategy should be ensuring that patient's taking the dose in the morning. You can try lowering the dose and see if that helps. You can consider switching the medication or maybe adding on like low dose trazodone. And the last of the early and time limited side effects are headaches, dizziness, and dry mouth. Just because I kind of been mentioning how the bupropion or Wellbutrin hasn't had the other side effects, here I'm just going to mention that it's actually the one that's most likely to cause the headaches. Effexor tends to cause a little bit more, both are like 25 to 30%, and then the rest of the SSRIs or SNRIs occur, so like 10 to 20%. And I'll also mention that bupropion is associated with an increased risk of seizures. And I'll just mention that it's proportional to dose and how quickly the medication is increased. And just a reminder that the relative risk is higher, but the absolute risk is still pretty low. It's like 0.1 to 0.4%. But the point here is if you have a seizure disorder or are already at an increased risk of seizures, like if you have an eating disorder or benzos or alcohol withdrawal, bupropion is typically considered contraindicated. All right, now let's get into the side effects that occur early but tend to persist. So it's good to inform patients that if they experience a side effect, it's not one that we expect to go away. So now let's talk about the side effects you've all been waiting for. So I think it's important to mention that any medication that inhibits the reuptake of serotonin will cause sexual dysfunction. It's noticed and reported by about 60 to 80% of patients, and given how in touch most people are with their body, I'd say it's probably 100% of patients have sexual side effects. For the vast large majority of patients, the side effects resolve once you stop the drug, but there are rare reports of people who claim that it's lasted for months to years or indefinitely. That said, I think the one-third thing applies here too. So for a third of people, it doesn't cause any distress whatsoever. For a third, it causes some distress, but it's tolerable. And for a third of people, it's pretty bad. So what does sexual side effects actually mean? So here's a nifty little chart. So this looks like a lot, but to quickly summarize, the three big things is it can cause a reduced desire for sex. It can cause difficulty maintaining arousal, so that translates to getting hard for men or getting wet for women. And lastly, it can significantly increase the difficulty it is to orgasm. So to try to capture that all really quickly, I would say it's likely that SSRIs cause sexual side effects. The most common is a reduced desire for sex, and then it can also cause erectile dysfunction or dryness, and then it can also make it difficult to orgasm. So with all that said, one way I would conceptualize how SSRIs work is it takes the joy from your genitals and it puts the joy into your brain. That's a joke. So what should you do about it? So the side effects tend to be dose dependent. So for some patients, lowering the dose makes the side effects more tolerable. But of course, you have to weigh the fact that you're decreasing the antidepressant effect of the drug. It's unclear how frequently switching to another SSRI improves the sexual side effects, but it can be worth trying. And it's good to note that Wellbutrin doesn't cause the sexual side effects. So it's definitely worth considering switching to bupropion if the patient reports the sexual side effects were intolerable from an SSRI. And I'll also mention that mirtazapine tends to cause the sexual side effects a little bit less. For men, you can consider adding, you know, Viagra or Cialis. Here's a wonderful chart that goes over a survey of what people did when they had the sexual side effects. I especially love that some people chose to get a new partner because of the sexual side effects. So for the people out there who chose Zoloft over their significant other, I recommend therapy. But all jokes aside, it's not the end of the world if you do experience the sexual side effects, but you need to be realistic if it does happen. If it's really that bad, you can consider switching to bupropion. It's possible lowering the dose will make it more tolerable. And I think it's important to note that, you know, some people introduce sex toys, they scheduled sex, you know, you can try to work around it with your partner. And who knows, maybe what you need is a new partner. So the next side effect that occurs early but doesn't go away is the emotional blunting. And in a weird way, I conceptualize the emotional blunting as kind of the far end of the spectrum of the beneficial effect the SSRIs have. So some people report that they have trouble feeling intense emotions and sometimes really any emotions at all when they're on the medication. So about 20% of patients who are prescribed the medication report apathy, and about 16% describe a sort of loss of ambition. So I should mention that most patients don't wind up feeling flat or unable to experience life's normal ups and downs. Rather, they find that in contrast to their periods of severe depression, they're actually able to enjoy life again with all of its joys and sorrows. And the leading theory as to why the SSRIs help treat depression is that they help with passive coping, which is tolerating a source of stress. So it's almost like they flatten the negative emotions, and then sometimes with it come the flattening of the positive emotions. But now, what can you do about it if a patient reports this side effect and it's negatively affecting their life? So this adverse effect is dose-dependent and reversible. So depending on the severity, your options are reducing the dose, you can switch to another SSRI, or you can switch to bupropion. All right, so now the side effects that occur later in treatment. So we'll talk about the one that patients care a lot about, and that's weight gain. And unfortunately, as with most things in life, it's complex, and there's not an easy answer to give to people. So some studies note an initial weight decrease followed by a gradual and sustained weight increase with the SSRIs. And now, it's important to keep in mind the majority of antidepressants really only cause a slight weight gain, but some big exceptions that you should be aware of are mirtazapine and Paxil. But there appears to be a lot of individual variability, so there's likely a subgroup of patients who gain a significant amount of weight, and a subgroup of patients who don't gain weight. And now, the mechanism isn't entirely clear, but it appears to be through changes in metabolism, eating patterns, exercise, or possibly all three. Now, just some interesting tidbits. Prozac tends to suppress appetite and induce a little bit of weight loss early on in treatment, but this only lasts a couple of months. And bupropion is the only antidepressant right now that isn't known to cause weight gain. And I know it was kind of a theme in this video that, you know, bupropion doesn't cause a side effect, but keep in mind it comes with its own host of side effects. So bupropion causes insomnia, decreased appetite, and for populations at risk can cause seizures. But in general, it's a pretty good choice for people who are worried about the SSRI side effects and would prefer kind of a different set of side effects. And also another little clinically relevant tidbit. So it was found that patients that experienced at least a 3% weight gain during their first month of antidepressant therapy were at higher risk of long-term gain than those who didn't gain significant weight in the first month. So this just kind of emphasizes the importance of checking weight before you start treatment. So if you carefully monitor weight through the first month of treatment, you can predict who's likely to gain a significant amount of weight and kind of prepare for it. So now what to do about it. First, make sure you educate the patient about the possibility of SSRI-induced weight gain. And you should especially educate patients with a high risk of weight gain. And for these patients, I would encourage, you know, a healthy diet and a regular exercise program. And that said, exercise and eating healthy are crucial to feeling good. And I think more mental health providers should be discussing how effective exercise can be in improving your mental health. All right, now the last side effect I want to talk about is the discontinuation syndrome. So all antidepressants cause a withdrawal syndrome if they're not tapered slow enough. And how bad the withdrawal syndrome is also linked to the half-life of a given SSRI. So I'm not going to go into the nitty-gritty of this, but it typically occurs a few days after stopping. It's not medically dangerous and generally self-limiting, but it is uncomfortable to the patient. So symptoms of the withdrawal include being dizzy, being nauseous, having a headache, being irritable. Sorry, I don't mean to give you a list, which I've been fighting against. Another fairly common thing that should be talked about with the patient is sensory disturbances that can occur. Patients describe these electric shock sensations, or what they call brain zaps. So here's a description. It's a sudden onset of dizziness, disorientation, and a sudden reboot of my brain senses. It almost seems like a really short period of dizziness that comes on fast and goes away fast, and it's just an odd sensation for someone to experience. So a decent rule of thumb for going off medications is going down by 25% each week for a 4-week taper. But really, you should be working with the patient to make sure that they go at a pace that works for them. And just a reminder that despite the unpleasantness of the withdrawal, the symptoms are not dangerous and they nearly always disappear with time. All right, so that wraps up the more common side effects that people occur with SSRIs. And just a reminder that this list was not exhaustive. And in the next video, I'll be talking about the more rare but dangerous side effects and the population-specific side effects.